Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. I have just finished reading a book that is so superb. If I were giving awards, it would be one of my awardees. The book is called Little Night. It's by my guest, Luann Rice. It's published by Pamela Dorman Books, and welcome, Luann.
Thank you so much, Connie. It's wonderful to be here.
Well, you take me into another world with Little Night. And it begins with a woman who has been sent to prison because she's accused of murdering her brother-in-law or attempted murder. Well, if ever a man deserved something, it is Frederick. But her sister Anne, instead of going along and agreeing with what Claire says, suddenly, as she's in the courtroom, she says, "Oh no, he never would have hurt me. She was jealous." Well, correct me if I'm wrong.
You know, it's true. That is how it opens. And what a shocker, you know, to be a sister and in that close sister bond and feel that you're helping your sister and defending her from something terrible and potentially deadly, and then to have her turn against you. But it's really, it's the dynamic of domestic violence.
Yeah. Well, she had seen this man be rough with her sister, but he's an artist. He's from Denmark. He blows glass. And he was rough with the children. So she hadn't seen the family for a long time, or I guess a couple of years. And she showed up with gifts for the children and for her sister Anne. And she knew that he would be out of the house. Well, surprise, he comes in. He is so insanely angry that he starts to choke the wife. Anne takes something, Claire takes something out of the fireplace and whacks him, and he goes even crazier. And then he has her charged with attempted murder.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's that thing that happens, I think, in abusive relationships where frequently the man appears to be so charming and so delightful, and everybody from the outside just thinks he's the best guy. And there's something else that goes on behind closed doors. My mother used to use a phrase, street angel, house devil.
Ah.
It's true that what goes on behind closed doors can be quite different. And the dynamic at the beginning of this book is that these two sisters, Claire and Anne, have been, you know, as close as sisters can be since childhood, since, you know, their whole lives. And
they had also had something that maybe made Anne put up with a man like Frederick, their father.
Yeah.
And the day they saw their father meeting a teacher from school, I think was the first time, and he kisses her, and they knew that at home he was really, in our family, it was angel without devil within. Yeah. He was that in that family.
Yeah, it's true. I think that girls, women, grow up with our dads and don't intend necessarily to recreate those relationships, but it can happen. Certainly in Anne's case, she was such a strong, feisty young woman, and she stated verbally, "I will not end up with someone like Dad, like the opposite is for me." And that's what she thought she was finding in Frederick, which makes it all the more horrifying and ironic. But
and she was looking to get married when she met Frederick at that art gallery. She had been dumped by someone else, and the two sisters were living in the family's home in, I guess, Chelsea area. Mm-hmm. And they had rented the other top two, but money was not too much in the household at that point. So here's Frederick, the artist, making big sums. Well, when he said, "You're coming with me for dinner," and he ignores Claire, Anne didn't say anything.
I know, and that is so, I mean, that's like a knife in the heart to a sister, I think.
Yeah.
You know, you're sort of together, and then all of a sudden, this famous and just erudite man shines his light on Anne, and then it's almost like Claire becomes invisible to her.
Do you have a sister?
I do. I have two sisters.
Two sisters.
So I love writing about sister dynamics. I feel like it's the endless material.
Yeah. Because it never changes. I mean, it never stays the same.
No, it never does. Yeah. And all through life, you know, and especially, I think we grew up being very, very close, and I drew on that, you know, to write about these two sisters and their, almost like their secret language and the bond they had where they could give each other a look, and one would look and the other would read it, and they would know what was intended. They'd know where to meet. They'd know exactly what to do.
She wasn't a sister, but she was as close, short of being a blood sister, a friend.
Oh.
In your book.
Yes, well, you mean the other friend.
Yeah.
Yes, it's true. They had a third wheel, Sarah.
Yeah.
She was like, you know, a best friend of both of the sisters, and she's kind of one of the witnesses. You know, she's somebody, and this happens. I mean, I feel like it happens so much in these situations where an outsider sees what's going on and really doesn't know what to do about it. You know, sees things changing and doesn't know whether to speak up or to interfere.
Yeah.
And bad things happen when you do interfere and when you don't interfere.
You can't win.
You know, it's true.
Now, Claire stands in trial. She has been going with a really nice man who's a ranger?
An urban park ranger, which they have in Central Park in New York City.
Which I did not know until I read your book. And she's sent off to jail or prison. Mm-hmm. And she's given a 2-year sentence where it could have been 12 years. It changes her life. It changes her relationship. His name is what, Peter?
Paul.
Paul. And it is as if part of her has been killed. Yeah. And Anne doesn't even try to see her. And the next thing she knows, Anne has gone off to live in Denmark with Frederick, and their lives have been cut. She has now become... But she's become the expert, what, on owls?
Mm-hmm.
Now, where, how? How did you get involved with owls in Central Park?
Well, it's true that Central Park is one of the world-class birding destinations. Because it's such a large piece of green on the eastern seaboard, it's one of the main places that migratory birds will land on their long route from the boreal forest down south. And so the Central Park has this really interesting, quirky, just fascinating group of regulars, birders who show up, you know, and every day, really, every morning, all through the year. I made Claire be one of those people because I feel that her time in prison and her horrible just break with her sister was so devastating and so traumatic that she was seeking peace and beauty in nature, and that's what she, you know, that's why she would migrate herself to Central Park every day. Her boyfriend, Paul, was an urban park ranger there, and so she would see him in the wild, so to speak. But it really is wild. Central Park is got wilderness to it. And there are owls. And you know, living in New York, if you're a bird lover, there's a secret email that goes out to all bird lovers that will be like an owl sighting, yeah, and we'll all go.
On a sort of a karmic plane, one I can identify with Claire coming out of prison and finding life again, with the odd owl that comes that nobody expected to be there, that rejuvenates in that park.
Yeah, thank you. I that part, it came to me. It was one of those magical things that happens when you're writing.
Yeah.
That I certainly didn't plan it, but as I was writing about it and owls, I realized, and it was sort of during, it was just past the time of the ivory-billed woodpecker being possibly sighted in the Arkansas swamp, and I thought, what if an extinct bird, an extinct owl, seemed to be in Central Park? And, you know, so I created the scenario where that might or might not be the case.
Then, out of the clear blue, and I do mean clear blue, there is a knock in a way on Claire's door, and it is her long-lost niece, Anne's daughter, who she had not seen since the child was three. She's been going to college at Emerson in Boston, and the family won't pay her tuition anymore. She says, I've got to find my aunt. She had been cut from the family. There is another ghastly part of the story. I'll see if you want to tell them about it. But she comes to New York, and it's as if two people finally, like a magnet, meet. Yeah. And the love is so great. She also, when she was kicked out of the home by Frederick and Anne, she had grabbed Anne's diary. And that becomes almost like a second book within this book.
It's that bond. I mean, it's true that here is Claire, who's been completely cut off and abandoned by her sister in the worst, most betraying way. And then to find out that her sister is also kicked out and estranged from her own daughter, and then to have Grit show up on her doorstep. It's true, I love the way you did this, because it's just as if they were meant to be together. I mean, they understand the way nobody else can in their own hearts, like what it's like to be, to go through such devastation, and it helps them individually, but also as, you know, to form a family.
And Grit is carrying a sorrow that she will never get over, but it's for her brother Gillies. And he had been the children were mistreated by this man, this monster, and it wasn't just Anne, it was her children, and yet she wouldn't break away from him at that moment.
I think that's one of the hardest things to understand about the dynamic of domestic violence, is that even in the face, given what the observable damage is, it can be so hard for the woman or the man, it does happen to both genders, but to have the objectivity to know how terrible it is. I mean, you might see it and you might sometimes know it, but then there's the other side. You know, it's like a kaleidoscope, it shifts. And then it's like, is it so bad? And he may apologize, or, you know, and there's the famous cycle of abuse that is true, and it's as real as anything. You know, it's the buildup of tension, the explosion, the cooling off period, and then the honeymoon. And they say that the honeymoon is the most dangerous to the people in the relationship, because that's when the promises are made, and it will never happen again. I won't do this anymore. Or if only you would change, if you would be more patient, if you would not be so demanding. And I believe that in Little Night, Anne is hoping still that, you know, she can keep her family together.
Well, the absolute epitome of it is, he says, I'm going to take you out to dinner. Where would you like to go? And she, because she's so happy, turns to him and says, where would you like to go? And he drives her home in a fit. Now, how much of this have you lived through that you could write it that I can feel it?
I'm so glad I could make you feel it, even though it's terrible, but thank you for that. I did go through an abusive relationship, and it was non-physical. It was an emotionally abusive relationship. And when I went for help to this wonderful little clinic in Connecticut, the women there told me, the counselors told me that in some ways, emotional abuse is worse because the scars are all on the inside. You know, it's like a strong woman will